Good morning. Welcome to this gathering of Wendell Christian Church. We're gathering here in the sanctuary on Zoom and on Facebook Live, and some of you will be viewing this later. We want you all here and in all those places and times to take a big, deep breath at this moment. For we have the capacity now to enter into a space where Christ is present in the Spirit, where we can have and share the love of Christ in our midst between one another. So here we go. We are going to share the welcome this morning on Palm Sunday. And we'll be lifting our palms in praise and worship and celebration in just a bit. And at the end of the message, and we hope that you take part in this week. This is Holy Week. This is a time in which we think about Christ in his last few days headed to the cross and us coming to understand what that means for us, for our world, for the future that lies ahead. So come and be part of this time and anticipate the week that lies ahead. Let's share our welcome this morning. Welcome, all who are here. Welcome. Welcome, my physical, mental, and spiritual self to this moment. Welcome. Welcome, Spirit of the risen Christ among us. Welcome. Together, we willingly enter communion, one with another. Welcome. Let's sing. Let's share our call to worship this morning on Palm Sunday. Jesus Christ came to be our King.
We have come to be Christ's people.
The King of Kings calls us to follow.
We have come to follow him.
Jesus Christ is our King.
And we are his people.
Amen. Let's sing our hymn of praise, all glory, Lord, and honor. Amen. And that really is the question of the day, and the question of this week as we head towards the cross and the resurrection, is will it be true that Jesus rules in our hearts today? And so we come to a time when we bow with one another and enter into prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we recognize that the invitation of this day is to gather with those who waved their palms and welcomed you into their lives, into their world. It's true that those who were there on that first Palm Sunday, the ones even who waved the palms, were still answering the question, who is this Jesus Christ? They were still answering the question, what will I do with this Jesus Christ? And so we come to you in all honesty with our own hearts asking those questions. Who are you to us? And what will we do in response to you showing up in our world? To you speaking? To you acting? To you going through what this week will help us remember as we remember and ultimately celebrate what has been accomplished through the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ? But on this day, we bow before you and we meet here. And in light of this Sunday and the season of our Christian year, we want to be honest enough to say, that we would like to be open to what you want to be in our lives and faithful to the calling that you give each of us and you give all of us. And now be with us as we pray, inhabit our prayers, move in our hearts, stir our souls. Allow us to be your people in ways we have not. Allow us to receive grace for those ways we have wandered away. Allow us to be filled with your Spirit and become people who bear the fruit of Jesus Christ's Spirit in our lives. We pray this prayer along with the church around the world. We lift praises because in all the places and all the languages and all the cultures, when people are having good days and bad days, when things are clear and when things are cloudy, you are God, and we offer you praise because you are God. But you are also love. You are also coming to us in Christ and in your Spirit. So we praise you as we can best understand you, and we give you our lives as best we can give you our lives. And we're so grateful for the reality that you've come to us in Jesus Christ, that you have lived and taught, and you've been faithful in the way that we will remember this week. But we also thank you that we can be a people who not only pray, but become the fulfillment of the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. We come now to a time of prayer, and we want to offer you time to share any updates or additions to our prayer list. I would bring a couple of things to your attention. Lord, we do thank you for being the one who is love. We thank you for being the one who knows all that is going on in our lives. We thank you for being a God who doesn't sit above us watching what we are going through, but that you are a God whose Spirit dwells within, the one in whom we live and move and have our being, and you participate in and are with us in everything that happens. We understand, and sometimes we even experience the reality that every good and perfect gift comes from you. But we live in a world where there's lots of hurt and suffering and toxic things going on because of all of us who, in one way or another, refuse to cooperate with your love that intends good and perfect. So we live in a world that has plenty of struggles. Some struggles are part of living as humans, as mortals on this earth. But many of those struggles are caused by people who are greedy, by some of us who will not cooperate and do not do what we know to do. And other things happen because we simply are not aware of what it means for us to do one thing and for others to experience the consequences of our choices. So help us to be aware, even as we have been reminded in these requests that we've said out loud, and Ben's reminder that we have friends and neighbors that are going through tough times that are caused by weather and no one's choice, that you would be the one that reminds us that you are with us, that you would help us to respond to needs. Not only would we be people of prayer, but that we would become the ways in which your Spirit moves to answer prayer. As you did in Jesus Christ, we will deliver help and healing. As you did in Jesus Christ, we will deliver hope and eternal life, because that is how your Spirit works through us into the lives of other people. And then your Spirit brings the new life in them. So be with us now. Receive our prayers. Allow us to be your people. In Jesus' name, amen. It's now my pleasure to invite everyone here, everyone watching on Zoom and Facebook Live, and anyone who watches it later, to find something that can be your bread and your cup. And in the bread and the cup, enter into a fellowship that is eternal and full of love, and share with us in this communion. We come here today on Palm Sunday, hoping that this bread and this cup can be a fresh experience of Christ entering into our world, a fresh experience of us offering praise and adoration and welcome to this Christ who enters, and that Christ would find us moving on from this day faithful in ways we've been shown by God's Spirit, and in ways that impact our world and help them to know and share the eternal life we have in Jesus Christ. So as we come to communion, I invite you to celebrate in light of the story and the promise of Palm Sunday. Let's sing our hymn of communion, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. Elder Cree Campbell. And I'll lead us in prayer.
Pray with me. Almighty God, we come again to the table as we do each week. That there are many, each individual who has a conception. We ask that as we take this bread, representing the body of Christ, sacrificed for the sins of the world, we will appreciate and we will have gratitude for the fellowship we are offered, not only through this, but through the scriptures and through the messages that we hear so often from places we may not expect. We ask that each of us, while enjoying the fellowship with each other, will also enjoy the fellowship of Christ in us, of the Spirit that will lead us as we follow the Savior's example as he walked daily. May we come to the place where this is not just a one time a week thought for us, but that each day we are renewed in our strength and our spirit and in our faith. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So I say, thank you. Now our elder, Tammy Fuller.
O great love, lover of all mankind, giver of life, thank you for this moment to come and pause with our brothers and sisters, not only here in this space, but around the world. Call to remember your great love, that no matter the cost, you chose love. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the reminder that you were willing even to sacrifice. Thank you for what the blood represents, the life-giving blood. May we love our neighbors as you love us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Jesus also took the cup. He said, "This is the cup, the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. Take and drink." Amen. We come now to a time where we just reflect upon the offerings that we each bring to support the life of our church and the life of the church around the world. There are so many things going on. I know this past couple of weeks, Amy and I have reflected on how we can best channel resources, some fresh resources coming because of being citizens of the United States of America, how we might channel resources better to those who suffer the most. Some of us have more than we need. Some of us struggle to have what we need. All of us are loved by God, and all of us through giving to the people that we support in our households, through giving to the people around us and through our world and through the church, are part of building the kingdom of God and supporting the kingdom of God. And we can say to one another, thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness. And thank you to God who supplies it all. In the name of Christ, amen. Let's sing our doxology. Amen. In the bulletin, it says Virginia Moore is reading scripture, but she's on the technology crew this morning and doing her service there. And Tammy Fuller is going to read our scripture.
So I'll be reading from the Revised Standard, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, verses 28 through 48. hear the word of the Lord. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And when he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.' As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, 'If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they're hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground and you and your children within you. They will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation of God." Then he entered the temple, and he began to drive out those who were selling things there. And he said, "It is written, 'My house shall be a house of prayer,' but you've made it a den of robbers." Every day he was teaching in the temple. The chief priests, the scribes, and the leaders of the people kept looking for a way to kill him, but they did not find anything they could do, for all the people were spellbound by what they heard.
Thank you, Tammy. Today I'd like to talk about the reality that Jesus Christ offers an alternative. And I would like to start out by saying, if you don't want an alternative, then maybe take a nap. If you think the world's just going along like it's supposed to, if you think your life is the picture of what it ought to be, then perhaps you could just listen this week and take my place next week and show us the way. I think what we need is an alternative. Obviously, some people live closer to God than others. Obviously, some times in history are more an example of what God wants than others. But Jesus Christ offers an alternative. And this week, beginning with Palm Sunday and going through Holy Week, going through the time that leads to the cross and the resurrection, is actually a time for the world, for all of us, and each of us to consider the alternative that Jesus Christ offers. Jesus Christ in this day and in this passage that Tammy read is actually weeping. There's a way it's going for the people he loves, and he hates it. He does not want what's coming. And he is crystal clear that what's coming is that the temple would be destroyed. He is crystal clear, and it got him killed. But he is telling the people, the way you've been doing it, the version of how you get to God and how you relate to your neighbor is not working and is going to cause a judgment that's coming just as a natural, God-given consequence in the world in which you live. But Jesus is not only weeping, he's loving. Have y'all ever loved someone who's gone astray and cried over their going astray? I guess if you know some people, enough people you have, my guess is if you've had children, it's happened either that first week of kindergarten or at some place when your kids were suffering and they were trying to find their way and they were missing it. And he was also warning. He was weeping and loving and warning the people. If you keep going this way, it'll keep going the way it's going. So this is a week that is hopeful and a week that is awful. And we will either be people who at the end of this week, as the new week dawns on Easter Sunday, are the people who have found in this week hope, or we will be the people who suffer awful from this week, who remain in the consequence and in the unfolding of the way our lives are going without Jesus. And for most of us, it's not a totally without Jesus or totally with Jesus. I don't know anybody here or that I've talked to in any significant amount in my lifetime that thinks they're perfect. And we can't be the people who think there's no hope if we are a Christian, because in Christ we understand that there is a victory. So this week we will see ourselves, this week we will look at Jesus, and this week we will get to choose who he is and who we follow. So let's unpack it a little bit and then celebrate what there is to celebrate this day. The first thing I have in my outline is the people who want the salvation Jesus Christ offers celebrate his arrival. You see, you have a version of each person that walks in the room, no matter what room you're in or what person it is, don't you? Somebody walks in the room, you're either, yep, glad they're here, or what? Ooh, maybe not. And the people there who were coming out with palms and celebrating, and the people who were plotting his death, were reacting to Jesus Christ coming, and his arrival caused some who want what they believe he offers, and they celebrate his arrival. So I ask the question, who will wave the palm? We'll wave them all together at the end too. Who will wave the palms? Well, it turns out there were people waving palms then that weren't going to be faithful later. And there were people waving palms then who would be. Who's going to wave the palms? It's the people who want what they think Jesus is offering. What do you think? What do I think Jesus is actually offering? Well, there are the sinners in the group. The sinners in the group are thinking, I used to think I was excluded, and Jesus comes along and hangs out with people like me and tells me I'm included. I used to think I couldn't be loved and I couldn't match up to the law, so I couldn't have God. In fact, I thought I had to go through all the rituals of the temple in order to find God. And Jesus comes along and says, the kingdom of God is happening in your midst. And he was actually talking to people who were not the high priest. He's saying God is with you right in personal contact, right there. And you're not the high priest. It's me you're talking to. Sinners see Jesus coming in. They believe, they didn't think they could be forgiven, but now they believe they could be forgiven. They didn't believe they were included. Now these sinners were thinking they were included, and they were waving their palms and go, whoa, this is such good news. What does God do for us who are sinners? He gives us grace, and it's a gift, and we receive the gift, and we wave our palms, and we follow Christ. But then there were other people who might have been waving palms or who were plotting against Jesus who were not sinners. They were righteous. Y'all know any righteous people? And I put quotes around both. Sinners, well, maybe they're the kind of people who are God are after. Or are righteous, maybe those are the people that don't get it. Maybe so. They see power in Jesus. They see him raising the dead and the crippled walking, and they see him feeding the 5,000, and they think, oh, there's power. There's something in this for me. And what I want is that power. And you'll see, not only in the Gospel of Luke, but in the other Gospels, not only there, but in the rest of the New Testament, and especially in the book of Acts, there are people who are charlatans and follow Jesus to be a charlatan. There are people who want power and wealth, and they follow Jesus, and they find followers who follow them, and they become wealthy, and they lord over people. The righteous were there too. Again, quotes around righteous. They saw power, they wanted the power, and they would follow Jesus as long as it was coming to power. But when it became clear at the end of this week that he was not offering power, they turned on him big time. All of a sudden, it might have dawned on them. Oh, yeah, he said the greatest in this kingdom is the one who serves everybody. Oh, that's not wrong. Never mind. The people who want the salvation of Jesus Christ, they will celebrate his arrival. And when we get out the bread and the cup each week, I think we are the people who are in that moment waving our palms and saying, welcome, Jesus. Be here with us. Show us who you are and make us who you want us to be. The second thing I point out is that we're part of power systems that will not accept Jesus as the Christ. And we're part of it. That doesn't mean we love them. We love all the systems that won't accept Jesus as Lord, as Christ. But we're part of them. So who will wave the palm and remain faithful? Who will wave the palms and serve everyone? Love their neighbor and love their enemies? Jesus Christ is the Son of Man. He's the Son of God. He's God in the world. And he's Son of Man, the full potential of what you and I as humans can be. So he comes into the world and into the power systems, and he says, if you power systems, which is the power system named George Fuller, the power system that is my family, the power system that is this church, the power system that is this town of Wendell, the power system that is governments and businesses, every organization has a power system. Have you noticed it? In fact, a lot of people use the word political as power system. Oh, this is getting all political, which means you're taking sides and using power. Well, those systems there, Jesus shows up and says, I'm going to tell you the potential of humans. I'm going to show you the potential in how I teach and how I live. I'm going to show you the potential. And the potential is not what you think. More power, Lord over, become special and isolated. No, I'm going to show you the power that is found in the way I love. Well, he came to show us what it is to help people who are suffering under the power of sin. Suffering under the power of sin. Everything that is not the way God wants it to be in relationship. With the world, with our neighbors, with ourselves, with our family. He came in and says, I'm going to tell you what to do with everyone suffering under sin. I'm going to tell you how to be saved. I'm going to tell you how to find the salvation from sin, from the ways you're relating that are not healthy, that are toxic, that are harmful to yourself and others in the world. Who will wave the palms and remain faithful? Turns out it's everyone being saved. The people who are moving from the way sin enslaves us to the way the Spirit of Christ sets us free, that's who continues to be faithful. After they wave the palms and Jesus enters their life, they're being saved from sin and all the ways that that manifests itself in us, and being saved to the kingdom of God, to the will of God, to the love of God. And he does it in system. So he would say, George, you know how it's going between your ears and in your heart and your soul? Let me tell you how to make that healthier and more beautiful and more loving. Oh, how about in your home? How about in your church? How about in your community? Let's go and work through the system and make this world. Oh, yeah, he taught us a prayer that modeled that, didn't he? We do that one every week. And then the next thing I point out is that Jesus Christ confronts the evil being done in the temple. In the passage Tammy read, he walks in the temple and he clears it out, right? What's he clearing out? What's the big deal? Didn't Solomon build that temple? Didn't David build that temple? Didn't it just get like it's supposed to be? Isn't that way it's supposed to be done? No. I'd like to give you three things to think about in terms of what was being done in the temple. One was it became a place of greed, the way it's put, is a den of robbers or a den of thieves. What were they doing? What they were doing was you couldn't have access to God unless you had the right sacrifice. And if you didn't have the right thing to sacrifice, you couldn't make your offering. So the way what they did was you had to buy the right sacrifice. Like what they could do is you could bring your sheep and they would find a blemish on your sheep and you'd have to buy their sheep to offer as a sacrifice. And when you did that, you couldn't use Roman money in the temple. And so you had to exchange your money, Roman money, for Jewish money, and they would make a profit on that. And then they would make a profit because your lamb wasn't good enough. And there was a whole world of, we're so greedy, we're going to make everybody think they're not good enough till they do what we want to do and pay for what we think they need to pay for. And greed controlled the temple. There's also the religious, self-righteous people. That was going on in the temple too, which meant that there were people that called themselves Pharisees and Sadducees and scribes, Herodians, who all thought they had it all figured out the way they understood it. And so they lived above people and in isolation. And there in the temple, you would experience it for sure. You can go to this court, but when you go to the inner court, you have to qualify. In fact, you have to be a man to get into that one. And then you, one day a year, somebody goes into the Holy of Holies, and there's this whole hierarchy and this whole way that you get to God. And we're the ones who get to go into the inner sanctuary. We're the ones that get to go there. Why? Because we checked off everything and kept the law. And yet there were people waking up who I believe were waving palms that were like, I can't match up. Have y'all ever thought everyone falls short of the glory of God? Y'all heard that one? Everyone. And so what do those people do? Well, some people just lock in and say, but that's not talking about us, because we know what the right things to do are and the wrong things to avoid. And it turns out that if you're self-righteous, you think God plays favorites. And so you see him hanging out, you see Jesus hanging out with somebody, and you say, what's he doing hanging out with those kind of people? Because we know God doesn't love those kind of people. And the third thing that was happening at the temple was they were exposing which master they served. You remember Jesus saying, you can't serve both God and wealth. Jesus said, here's how it is. If you want power and wealth in this world, if you want to make your home and your security in this world, the power systems, the hierarchies of this world, if you want to be the favorites and the most wealthy and let everyone else suffer, then you will be isolated from me. And in Luke 10, that we've read earlier, a rich guy says, how can I have eternal life? And what does Jesus say? Love God with all your heart, soul, body, mind, strength. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. And that's what he says. What do you say? And he says, oh, I've done that. And he says, okay, then let's break with greed. Let's break with loving wealth more. Sell everything you've got, give it to the poor, and now become a disciple of him. And what happens? He walks off sad. Why does he walk off sad? Waved his palm, then he put it down. Ain't going there. Not doing that. And then you have in 19, and the temple is cleared that we just read. Tammy just read for us. And he clears the temple, and he's really clear. Well, let's remember that just before that, we didn't go back all that far and read the whole story, but there was the guy Zacchaeus, remember? Was he wealthy? Yes. Was he in a powerful position? Yes. And when he waved his palm, what I mean by that is he took Jesus home with him. Jesus walked into his life and went home with him. And he waved his palm and then said, I'm going to give. You notice he made it right. He did his amend. He made himself right with the people he had cheated. And Jesus said, this man is now a son of Abraham. You know, you want to just say, woo-hoo, man, I like it. If I get that messed up, it's messed up. You see, I'm still judgmental of the tax collector. You see that? So if I get that messed up and I can still get in, well, then I think I might could get in, because I know I'm messed up, but look at Zacchaeus. The next thing I point out is that Jesus Christ's alternative will begin and unfold as the temple is being destroyed. He is clear in the passage that Tammy read. He is telling them, it's going to be bad. You're going to die inside the walls of this city. There are going to be ramparts set up around you. You're going to die. Children are going to die. It's going to be awful. And it's going to be awful because you kept trying to be a political power, Israel. Israel, you kept trying to be a political power and have power and might. And I wanted you to be a spiritual people. And as long as God's people try to be powerful in political ways, they will be anti-Christ. I want to say it again so that I can keep from being misunderstood. Every time God's people want political power to maintain control and dominate, they are anti-Christ. Every time. You see, I'm saying it three times. Every time. And when that happens, that power system will be destroyed. And it is clear in Scripture. Political systems and nations come and go, right? And I know every one of us thinks ours is the exception. We're going to be the one that's smart enough to learn and turn around. And I actually believe he can. I actually believe we can repent and be healed. Yeah, is that weird? No. It's right there in the Scriptures. And it's right here in this. But here's the way it's going to go. The temple's going to be destroyed. And Jesus is saying on the other side of that, you're going to understand that the angels have broken through heaven. And the Son of Man is descending and ascending. You're going to see that the salvation of God has come. You're going to see on the other side of destroying what you thought would work, that there is something that does work. So Israel, even though Israel would not, for that time, the spiritual Israel, would not stop trying to be a political state with power, not stop trying to be a superior religion where they had God and no one else did. The people found that the Spirit of Yahweh, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of the one true God, Yahweh, would, remember the rest of Luke and Acts? Remember what happened? Read it. Celebrate. The Jews and the Gentiles are in. And there's no temple to reference? You don't find people in the book of Acts going, hey, don't y'all stop preaching the good news. We got to get back to the temple. If we don't get right on sacrificing these lambs, we can't know God. That's not what happens in the book of Acts. Everyone has access to God, and there's no nation and no religion that holds a monopoly in them. Jesus Christ's alternative will begin as the temple is destroyed. And I would just like to say for every one of us, whatever our real temple is, whatever our real master is, whatever the sin is that we're trapped in, we'll wave our palms and then we'll decide, do we stay with our temple? Do we stay with our sin? Do we stay with our alternative to Jesus Christ, or will we take Jesus as our alternative? Will Jesus be Lord? And the next thing I point out is that the evil system's plan to deal with, thus try to stop Jesus Christ. Are they plotting against Jesus then? The answer is yes. You can shake your head since we're not supposed to all speak out loud. Are they plotting against Jesus? Well, yeah. And do they all still plot against Jesus? Yeah. That's the way it works. Okay, here's something I hope I can help you understand, because it was awful as I came to understand. So I know this could be uncomfortable, but I think we need to go there. This week, we will go to the cross, and we will discover who we are at the cross. This week, we are going to go to the cross. If you pay attention to the scriptures that are being read this week, as we approach the cross, we're going to go there. We're either going to be people who are at the cross weeping because we see that Jesus was pure love and that Jesus was the Christ and that Jesus is dying, and we have to end up with a Christ who dies. We have to end up with a Christ who loves, even though that Christ suffers. We either are going to be those people who are weeping and waiting and struggling to believe, and believing sometimes and doubting sometimes and wanting to hold on to, could Jesus really be who Jesus said he was? And we could be the ones that are at the cross hoping, maybe even though he's dying this way, maybe he's still telling us the truth about that. Even though he's dying this way, maybe he really is the picture of how God loves. But then there are the other people at the cross. Again, I want it to be. I just faced off with it again this morning. It was tough. I was kind of late getting to the shower this morning. I was wrestling inside myself. I could also be those people who are standing at the cross going, oh, you want me to love those people? Oh, yeah. You want me to love those people? Well, then crucify you. And I'd use the F word, but I might get fired. But what they say is crucify you. We use the F word. We use the most most awful statement when we tell people, you get out of here. You will not make my life any different. You will not change it. You will not be the one I follow. They said, crucify you. and sometimes in the morning after my prayer life, and I just got done saying I wouldn't. By the end of the day, I'd say crucify all over again. Oh, yeah, I know you said love those people. I ain't gonna. They get on my nerves. You said love those people? I think they're sinners. And Jesus is saying, well, that might actually be true. And that's who I love. You too. We might be the people who are mocking Jesus as he died. See how it goes for you? You say love those kind of people, love that way, live that way. You end up weak. You end up on a cross, and we mock you. Our sin is on the cross. Our sin is on the cross. And with our sin on the cross, Jesus is going to hang there and tell us what he does with our sin on the cross. Evil system, including the one named George Fuller, will sometimes or consistently, fewer times, or maybe very few times, crucify Christ. Try to stop him from having what Christ wants in my life and in our life. And finally, we will have to decide who we serve. The way he says it in the passage that Tammy read was the stones will cry out. I don't think he's saying, oh, if you don't do this, lungs will appear inside of a rock and there will be a larynx. And the lungs and the larynx will put together and you'll start hearing some songs coming out of those rocks. I don't think he's talking literally. I think what he's saying is, go ahead, try to stop it. I'll tell you how it is. If you're not going to go along and cooperate, it's still going to happen. You're going to look around in the world and the way it unfolds, and you cannot stop what God's up to. Can't stop it. Can you stop it? Just y'all shake your head. No. Just, you can't stop it. And I'm telling you that if you wave your palms and you stay faithful, you'll be going, oh, hallelujah. Save now. Hosanna is what the word is that means save now. Save now. Have it your way now in my life and in our church and in our world. But in Luke, he tells the parable of the soils. Do you ever read the parable of the soils? Some people call it the parable of the seed, but there's actually the same seed every time. The word of God comes every time. And in some places, you put the word of God, and it's gone. In some places, you put the word of God, it springs up. I'm waving my palm, and then, nope, it gets choked out, and then no more. And in some soils, sometimes it lands on a soul. Sometimes it lands in a church. Sometimes it lands in a community. Sometimes it lands in some people. And the book of Acts says, look what happens when it lands in good soil. The book of Acts is about how a little group of people changed the whole Roman world. Because the seed landed in fertile soil. I find myself wanting to be fertile soil. And then y'all keep listening. And sometimes I don't know. Because I see what that would mean. Dietrich Bonhoeffer died as a martyr. He was hung and killed in a Nazi concentration camp right as the war was ending. If they had waited a few more days, he would have been liberated because that concentration camp was liberated. But they hung him and he died. And he wrote books that I think are among the best books ever written about following Christ. One's called The Cost of Discipleship. Another's called Life Together. In fact, I might put that at the top of everyone's reading list. Life Together, where he talks about who the church is in our life together in Christ. But he also wrote a book called Ethics. Get this, he wrote Ethics while in a concentration camp. He's going to write a book about how to love everyone the way Christ loves it while you're being treated the way you get treated in a concentration camp. Would anybody like to say that sounds like Jesus on the cross? That's what it sounded like to me. And here's what he says, among other things, many eloquent things in that collection that was put together after he died, because he had been writing it along the way, and people that loved him, his family and friends, put it together. He said this, unless the soil has been prepared, the seed shrivels up and loses its inherent fruitfulness. Unless the soil, me, you, Wendell Christian Church, the people who are going to consider Jesus, and wave their palms or not, and keep being faithful or not. are going to decide if we do the work to prepare the soil that is our lives, our soul. The church, all of us as souls where the word of God takes residence. So if you would, in using Jesus' words, what we're going to find out is who's seeking, because they'll find Jesus. We're going to find out who's asking, because they're going to be given Jesus. And we'll find out who's knocking, because they're going to enter. They're going to live their life as part of the kingdom of God. They're going to enter the kingdom of God. That means live your life in harmony. Well, Peter's the example. You know Peter. You can just see him, right? Jesus wants to go to Jerusalem. Peter says, don't go to Jerusalem. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. I need to go to Jerusalem. You can see Peter like, woo, we love Jesus. Woo, woo. And then what happens later? Do you know Jesus? No, I don't know. Are you sure you don't know him? No, I don't know. I think we saw you with him. Blankety blank, I don't know him. Because he does cuss there. And he's unfaithful. But I just want you to know he keeps showing up. Hey, y'all, I'm going to be unfaithful and I'm going to keep showing up. And then I'm going to be faithful and I'm going to show up. So if y'all are faithful or unfaithful, keep showing up. You know why? Peter kept showing up. What happened to Peter when he kept showing up? The Holy Spirit got a hold of Peter in some new ways and big ways, and he finally ended up including Gentiles. That's us. And so I think he not only went through waving his palm. Ultimately, tradition says Peter was crucified upside down, because when they were going to crucify Peter, he said, I don't deserve to be crucified right side up like my Lord. And they granted his request to be crucified upside down. Peter, the one who was going to withhold God's love to Gentiles, ends up being one who's crucified upside down, being faithful. Those are the ones of us who will change the world. And if we don't, those are the ones of us who may wave our palms for a time, but who will maintain the world as it is, and continue working towards not only the destruction of Jerusalem, as Jesus predicted in his time, but the undoing of our world in our time. I think if we would hear the word of God today, we would weep because of how it will go if we don't become faithful and let God do the God's work in us. I think we would also be ones who would be warning one another and hopeful. I can't help but believe that Jesus was saying, I know this is going to be hard. In fact, by the end of this week, he's praying if there's any other way. But why was Jesus faithful? For the same reason we can be. We can actually believe by faith that God cannot be absent, cannot be stopped, and will never be anything but love. Could we believe? I believe if we learn the lessons of the weak-headed in front of us, we can believe that. We can be changed and the world will be changed. So, I want to invite you, wave your palms. Okay, if you think you might be unfaithful later, wave them anyway. Because we're going to worship Christ. And our hymn of commitment is When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. And I would just like us to remember to look and listen as we finish reading this last week of readings in the book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke, as we go through the week. And I divided it up like it's a week, those readings. And so let's wave our palms now and listen deeply as Christ enters the world this week and we become the people of God to the glory of God. Amen. Amen. Let's sing. you would, place one hand on your heart. And just even think of it as you bring your hand to your heart, Christ entering in, Christ being present, Christ riding the colt into the town that is the soul of your heart. You can be there because Christ is there, and you are made in the image of God and the likeness of God, and the Spirit of God dwells within you. So open up fresh your life and become the place where God takes residence, become the soil that is fertile and prepared for the Word of God to bear fruit in your life. Now offer your hand to the world. Now go out. First, love the people in your home. First, love the people you meet in your community. Then expand your heart to include everyone that is in the love of God, your neighbors, your community, your world, even your enemies. Because as you go, you are the light and the leaven working its way through the world, dispelling darkness and filling what is the world with the love of God and the presence and Spirit of God. May it be so in us, among us, and through us. Amen. A couple of announcements. Just remember that this week we will have the Bible study at 10:30 on Wednesday, so you can sign into just like you do worship. And also we'll have a devotion in Holy Week on Wednesday at 7:30 in the morning. The Window Council of Churches is putting together a video that will be made available, and I'll send the link to Glenn, and he'll share it like he shares the bulletin and the invitation to the Zoom. And during the week, you can watch the video. They've invited me to do the devotion within that video, but several ministers in our community will be part of that video, and you'll be able to know it. And also, at noon on Good Friday, this Friday, I will be doing a live, and we will record a devotion at noon on Friday. So I invite you to join that as you would join worship, and we will be together then. Is there any other announcements that we need to make this day? All right. Well, I do wish you well this week. If there's any commitment that you've made, please be willing to share it with someone who's a brother or sister in Christ.